Now, the threat landscape today, when we are talking about EPP or EDR, and you definitely will actually go to a customer that has already a solution on EPP, right? Could it be would it be Symantec or McAfee and any other products itself? They definitely has an EPP. But however, right, we also actually have challenges when we come into EDR. So when we talk about EDR, this might be a new space for your customers, right? They might not actually have an EDR solution. So this is always a dilemma where your customers, when you actually advise your customer, is EPP enough or do you need something more to actually provide that visibility and contextual information? Now, I would actually mention here, especially in terms of Indonesia market, it is actually huge itself, right? Demographically, the some of the areas itself, you might actually encounter bandwidth restriction itself. We actually understand the market very well, you know, bandwidth restriction. And then some in certain areas is that you might not even have full control of the endpoints. And there are many, right? Tens of thousands of nodes itself we are looking at. It is not hundreds or 200s or 1,000. We are looking at tens of thousands, how we actually manage them effectively. And if this is the case, right, in order for business to operate more effectively, you need to actually open up more vectors for business to actually run itself. Now, let me actually explain what is actually opening up more vectors. In the past 10 years, the machines are very siloed. That is the reason why you need EPP, and it is relatively enough, right? EPP actually looks solely at the machine's problem itself. When there's actually threats coming in, when there's actually malicious activities coming in, the EPP, the endpoint protection itself will actually remediate and quarantine the files. Now, we are looking at the problem in EPP space. We are looking at things in a very silo manner, all right, in a very individual manner. Today, what we are looking at is at attacks that be actually very advanced. Even the case study that I'm going to go through with you on the ransomware, it is not just a simple infection on an operating system. It is actually a series of techniques that is actually being done, that is actually being conducted by the attackers itself, that actually the ransomware could be activated very wide, right, across tens of thousands of PC, and very deep. Deep in the sense that if, let's say, you want to disinfect, it becomes extremely difficult because there are so many parts of the machine has already been infected. Now, so how do we actually go about doing this, right? EPP or EDR? Now, in our cybersecurity world, if we actually would suggest, we would always want to actually go through a layered approach technology. What do we mean by layered approach technology? Now, we have to understand that there's no solution that is a silver bullet that is able to solve everything. Now, the EPP solve one part of the problem. The EDR solve another part of the problem that the traditional signature-based kind of technology is not able to detect. And therefore, you need something that is actually identifying based on behavior, which means that it is actually as equal, as important as it is to have EPP and EDR together to actually maximize the protection level within the organization. Now, let me actually bring you through. This is not what I say. Let me bring you through a little bit of an example, what is actually happening out there in the market. In 2020, SolarWinds was a supply chain attack itself. There was an APT, there was a backdoor that was actually being used by the attackers on the SolarWinds solution platform itself. And they have actually been actually doing data exfiltration itself quietly at the back end. Now, this could, you know, not only be actually done from a supply chain perspective. If you look at, you know, banking industry, financial services industry itself, FSI, or even manufacturing plants itself, intellectual properties, kind of information could potentially be stolen out from such an attack. So this is APT, it is just happening 2020. Right? And this has to be actually resolved from an EDR perspective, from an EDR standpoint, because there isn't any form of malware. There could be one or two 0-day that was actually undetected, but really it was the vulnerability and it was the behavior of all this that could also be tracked, could be actually potentially being effectively tracked by the EDR technology. Now, as we actually move on to my right side of the screen itself, this is actually happening this year itself. In fact, a few months ago, it was actually a Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack. Right, so this is actually ransomware, and I would actually classify that as potentially it is a functionality of EPP, right? If the EPP is able to actually identify this threat, this could actually be potentially eradicated. However, you know, this is actually a very established company, organization itself, and it still has gaps. It still was actually being penetrated. And this is the case study I'm going to bring you through to the dark side 2.0. The amount of sophistication that is being done on this espionage or this campaign was actually very, very complex itself. Okay, so I will say that, you know, ransomware today, it becomes like an endemic, right? In the past, we thought, and a lot of people actually thought that we could actually solve ransomware from antivirus, right? I think everyone here would have known the history. Then when we came out with Zero Day, we thought that we can solve it using AI. But having said that, right, today, AI technology-based scanning has been in the market for almost 5 to 7 years. Every single EPP technology has AI, but we still face ransomware. So as I mentioned, it is not a silver bullet, right? As technology evolves, you need layer approach, and we have a very effective way how we actually address that. And this is part of the demonstration data as well. Now, I would actually talk about some of the use case that attackers actually use. One part here is the Retina locker itself. As you can see, this is a form of ransomware. All right. I think this is also very, in the past few weeks itself, we have also seen application that is actually vulnerable to such an attack. Could be ConnectWise or could be Kaseya. All right, how this actually works is it involves in multi-stage attacks itself. The first stage is actually to infect the infrastructure, right, by deploying tasks. So imagine today, if let's say we are looking at Fowler's attacks, Fowler scripts actually implanted within the organization, they could actually infect your registry. They could actually put in something like scheduled tasks so that it actually runs that task at a particular time. And usually what we actually seen from our research and from our IR experience is that they become activated in the middle of the night, where everyone or the SOC team is actually at the least worrying part. They are actually looking at the threats actually very minimally from the SOC analyst team standpoint. So usually they will actually schedule all the tasks in the middle of the night, low and slow, right? They do not actually download huge payload. They actually download separate payloads itself to disguise and to hide away from that detection mechanism itself. Now the first part here is this, right? The second part, what happened here is that you know that ransomware today is a nuisance. Okay, it's a nuisance, I would say. We are trained, right, by regulators, even the United States of America Department of Defense or, you know, FBI. We have always been encouraged from a standard or default way is to not to actually pay ransomware. Because if we were to, or the victims were to pay ransomware, then we could potentially be siphoning out this monetary thing into things that you do not want, right? Things that is unwarranted for, like for example, to support, you know, illegal activities. So that default way was not to actually pay the ransom. And you could actually hear many vendors itself also mention about, technology vendors itself also mention about, if you pay ransomware, you might not even get back the your data, because they could have been, you know, not a proper way to actually decrypt the traffic. So this is actually very extremely, I mean, in the past 5 years itself, you would actually, if you have actually have a ransomware, I think it was quite straightforward whether to pay or not to pay, right? If let's say the data is not of very sensitive data, you'll probably forgo. Now, attackers also understand this trend, okay? The default, the most default way is not to pay ransomware. So how do they actually come around with it? The way how they come around with it to make sure that you pay the ransomware is to hold your data, not to encrypt your data. Part of the reason is to hold your data. So on this second part here, as you can see from this screen, they do data exfiltration. So once they do a data exfiltration, this is what we so-called the double extortion technique. The double extortion technique means that there is two revenue for them to actually extort you. Number one, they encrypt your files. If you don't pay, I would actually post another threat that I will sell your sensitive information to your dark web. Okay, so when they sell this information to your dark web, then it becomes the decision becomes very complex. You have to actually think about that, whether now I should pay ransomware or I risk my information being sold in the dark web. And I don't know what information the attackers have gotten over my organization itself. So this becomes extremely painful. And rest assured, we have customers that actually undergo this kind of tremendous decision, stressful decision. And this is actually something that we have to be mindful. Now, the third part here is that when data exfiltration has been done, the attackers actually will do the ransomware attack, and it will also, the attackers will always, in this Ragna attack itself, right, what they do is that if you don't actually pay to a certain time limit itself, right, they give you a time limit. If you don't pay within this day or hour itself, then I will start to release 10% of the information to the dark web, and they will show proof to you. And as time continues, if you still don't want to pay the ransomware, then they will actually continue to release more information to the point where you will actually give up and probably pay the ransomware. So we the cyber reason, actually, what we are actually looking here is that we are trying to help you to actually prevent as much possibility as such an attack from happening. And that's the reason why cyber reason has a research team called the Nocturnus team. All right, the Nocturnus team has been actually very actively, right, the research team was actually is based in Israel itself. We have always been actually identifying multiple attack groups itself, multiple APT group. But what was really interesting is that we pay a very high degree of attention to DarkSide, this attacker group. And true enough, DarkSide has been very active. They have always been in the business of ransomware as a service in the past 1 year. Now, the Corona pipeline was one part that was actually being conducted by the DarkSide 2.0. What they did here was that they actually do the double extortion technique. They actually exfiltrate data before they do the ransomware itself. Now, because of all the knowledge that we have, right, that we have been identifying DarkSide 2.0, we are capable. The solution is today is a lot more resilient to such a complex attack itself, especially involving in double extortion. Now, if let's say you are interested in the techniques, tactics, and procedures of how DarkSide 2.0 operates itself, this is a high level. Again, it uses exactly the same technique. Compromise, establish foothold, right? These guys actually put the malware within the shared drive. It didn't even actually, you know, try to ask all the devices to gather the payload from the cloud. They actually put it within the shared drive so that the distribution becomes much faster and much easier. At the same time, they also conduct data exfiltration, and then they provide a ransomware note. And again, on the seventh point is, if a ransomware is not being paid, they will actually release the information. Now, exactly, we have a blog that actually talked about DarkSide 2.0. What is the techniques, tactics, and procedure that they have used? Exactly, PowerShell, you know, all these kind of very common things that you can hear of, can see of, is being published in our blog. We will be glad to furnish you with more information on detailed information of how we actually identify DarkSide 2.0. Now, with this case study itself, why do I actually bring out this thing? Is if ransomware is one prominent problem that your customer is actually facing, we do have the knowledge, we do have the expertise, we do have the technology to specifically identify such a kind of complex ransomware that is actually that will happen now or in the future in your in your customer's environment space. Now you could see one thing. I'm just providing you with a situation here is a kind of different view of how you actually manage alerts. Now there are many ways, or you know, sometimes we might be too into identifying threats which means relates back to efficacy. Now, when we are actually testing a product, a lot of times when I talk to my customers itself, they were actually always talking about, you know, I want to actually understand your efficacy. I want to actually do a bake-off. I want to actually look at hundreds, thousands, or thousands of malwares. And I want to see how much you can address, how much you can capture, and how much you cannot, you know, capture itself. And then based on that, they actually use a baseline to do a scoring and, you know, identify whether this product is better in capturing malware or malicious activity versus the other one. Now, let me actually explain to you, this might not be, in the past, it might be relevant when we are talking, not talking about APT or, you know, things like lateral, that move laterally, right? Because we are looking at a simple device itself. Now, this is the situation, right? That's the reason why some of the technology vendors, when they actually develop the way how you manage crisis, how you manage the alerts, it becomes very silo. It becomes like an alert that pop up, then I will actually try to react to that. Now, but we have to understand, we are not looking at the enterprise network. We are not looking at hundreds or tens of PCs itself. We are looking at thousands, tens of thousands. Now, if every single device generates, you know, an alert every 5 minutes itself, you'll know that you will be swamped by alerts, and there's no physical way or mental way that you can actually address all these problems, right, from your SOC team. I can almost guarantee you that. So you might have alerts that is actually being triggered, but it's not your intention to leave it out, but you're just, there's just too much alerts for you to actually address that. Now we call it alert fatigue. This is the terminology, the alert fatigue. This is the terminology that a lot of people actually, a SOC team actually use, whereby too much alerts and you can only handle a handful. Now, so this is actually kind of a management or a crisis management that reflects back to alert-centric reporting itself. Now, Cyber Reason, although, you know, we know that efficacy plays a very important role, but nevertheless, we also want to help our customers to better manage the solution in a very, very effective way. Now, how do we do that? Which I'll actually cover in details when we actually talk about the malops and CMC. Now, before I actually go into that, right, a lot of times our customers will actually ask, hey, Inghao, will you be able to actually tell me what are the features and functionalities that you have? Maybe, you know, I try to map back whether do I require all this. Now, this actually, let me actually share with you, since this is a webinar, this is actually very high level use case. The Cyber Reason technology has the NGAV, which encompasses the AI and the signature. And you know that, you know, signature is known, malware, AI is actually unknown. We have a capability of the anti-ransomware technology we built within the solution itself. Again, I will actually mention that this anti-ransomware is not just, you know, riding on the signature or the AI-based kind of detection, but it is really on indicators of behaviors, right? How this particular application behave, that we track down that this is actually a ransomware. And this, by far, the way how we actually deploy it on the customer's environment and the feedback is this is by far the most effective way of how we actually address the ransomware. Now, again, the third part here is the fouler's attack. No need to say, these are actually some new techniques that is being used by the attackers. And the last part here is also important to give you that contextual information, that timeline or event. That's where the EDR component actually comes in. Now, fortunately today, when we are looking at all these use cases itself, you are riding on a single agent. There's no need for you to install multiple agents. There's no need for you to actually cross-reference to different platforms to address all these use cases. Now, like what I mentioned early on, the traditional kind of, you know, alerting based on alert centric is, I would say, passé. Now, let me actually bring you into the forward looking kind of reporting or how you manage the whole situation. It's by means of what we coin to be malicious operation. In short, malloc. So I always think about that malloc. When I talk about malloc, you know that it is actually a series of malicious operation actually being consolidated into a single alert mechanism. Okay, so that is why we actually don't call it a malware alert. So, like, for example, you have seen a lot of technology, they call it, you know, I will actually flag out malware alert, malware alert, malware alert. But this is really not. Now, let me actually share with you what constitutes to a malloc itself. A malloc actually involved in collecting data from the endpoint. This is actually the very bottom of the pyramid, where you have vast amount of information, vast amount of telemetries that's feeding in to a next generation kind of analytic platform, which is the Cyber Reason platform itself. So you have this raw data all feeding into the endpoints. And within all this, right, what we actually do is that we understand, you know, the process, we understand the network connectivity, we understand the registries, we understand which users are actually using the system, we also understand the memory. So these are all the Intel track itself. Now we have the data and we have our technologies, right, our IOCs and so forth itself. So with these two, right, we will apply that track intelligence that we have across the data telemetries that we have seen. All right, so once we actually apply this, right, how do we actually correlate that information and how do we actually apply it seamlessly? It is through the cross-machine correlation engine. So this is the CMC. Also, this is actually very proprietary to Cyber Reason. So we help you to actually do AI threat hunting, artificial intelligence threat hunting. So you are very sure, pretty sure that, you know, with all these IOCs and everything, we kind of use this data and match the data and actually get contact, get meaningful. I would say the keyword is actually meaningful. You could actually get a lot of results itself, but if it's not meaningful, it is wasting your time. So we get meaningful information. Now, why do I say so? Because when I actually provide you with a malloc, before I actually reach the malloc and I actually identify a threat, I would provide you with evidence and the suspicious activity. So for example, right, if let's say there is telemetry that comes across different devices itself, we will actually tell you that, you know, this is actually the first piece of evidence that I think is malicious. And I start to collect my evidence. That could be actually in a operation itself, there could be 10 evidence. So I collect all the evidence. I know that, you know, this is actually homing into certain remote IP address. This is one evidence. Okay. It is actually having a very weird kind of child process. This is also one evidence. Okay. But, you know, if let's say I actually crumb everything up to you, hey, Mr. So-and-so or Mr. So-and-so, Madam So-and-so, I tell you, this is actually going to a remote IP address. This is something malicious. Now, if you look at this, if you identify threats based on this, you again fall into the alert fatigue trap itself. Why? Because there are too much already. So the idea here is that we don't use one evidence to tell you that this is a malloc. We use several evidence, and through our CMC, again, we identify within this five evidence itself, it creates a suspicious activity, right? And then the next five, it creates another suspicious activity. So there might be a lot of suspicious activities that resulted in because a handful of evidence that we collected. And ultimately, with all these suspicious activity, we create a malloc. So when the malloc actually happens, we help you to identify we are clearly able to identify what is the root cause to that problem. What is the root cause? Number two, your evidence, why we say that this is actually malicious. And most of the time, if you have used our platform for long enough, you will be very confident and you probably wouldn't even need to see the evidence. You will actually do the necessary remediation on the fly itself. Now, the evidence records, everything is mostly for the purpose of, you know, if you want to actually report to the higher management, or, you know, you want to actually show the stakeholders or the server owners what is happening, there is a way for you to actually present all this information very effectively across the stakeholders. Now, this is a next generation kind of reporting mechanisms that we are educating our customers how you do it in a more effective way. Now, this is actually a summary of what I actually mentioned earlier on. You have the multi-layer prevention. We have actually detection sensors or modules to identify all the threats itself. We could prevent it, but at the same time, while we are preventing it, we want our customers to understand, to know exactly what is happening within your environment itself through the cross-machine correlation. And then basically, Cyber Defense Platform is the platform that you are always spending most of your time. If you invest in Cyber Reason, the analyst will be always spending a lot of time looking at this platform itself. to identify threats as well as to understand the environment's posture or what is actually happening within the environment. Now with that, I'm going to pause a while. Is there any questions? Let me take a look at the chat group. Is there any questions that I can help to answer as of now before I move on? I mean, from a technology perspective, how cyberism comes in differently to address the market. No, if not, let us actually go into diving into this demonstration itself. Let me stop my share. Give me 30 seconds while I log into my, I was logged out of my platform. All right.